is the Thriving Dentist Show with Gary Takas, where we help you develop your ideal dental practice, one that provides personal, professional, and financial satisfaction.
Welcome to another edition of the Thriving Dentist Show. I'm Gary Takas, your show host. Very excited to have a new friend on the Thriving Dentist Show, Dr. Paul Henny. Hey, Paul, how are you?
Good morning, Gary. Great to be with you.
Let's see. I didn't check my Google Maps, but I know my geography pretty well. You're outside of Roanoke, Virginia, in the western side of the state of Virginia. And I believe that puts us about 2,200 miles apart. Does that sound about right?
Yeah, that's roughly in the ballpark, I think.
Hey, we are going to have a great conversation. And if you're a new listener to the Thriving Dentist Show, you're in for a real treat. If you are a veteran, regular listener, let me start by saying thanks. We appreciate you. And you, too, are in for a real treat because we're going to talk about a topic that is I'm absolutely passionate about, and Paul is passionate about as well. And let me frame it by saying that we're going to talk about the humanistic or the people side of dentistry. Paul, is that a good way to kind of characterize some of the things we're going to talk about today?
I think that frames it perfectly. I think, you know, dentistry is a people business, whether we want to acknowledge that or not. And the more effective we get at that piece, the happier we'll be, and the happier our patients will be, and the healthier our patients will be. So, I mean, to me, this is sort of the epicenter of all of it. Mm. So I'm excited to share some of that with the audience today.
Well, I share your passion. We're also going to talk about a mentor, someone that has been of tremendous influence to you as well as me, Paul, and that'd be Dr. Bob Barkley. If that's a name that's new to you as a listener to the Thriving Dentist Show, we're very excited to be introducing you posthumously to Dr. Bob Barkley. He passed away in 1977, sadly in a plane crash. That was 1977. I started in this wonderful profession in 1980. Paul. So Bob was gone 3 years by the time I started, but I was introduced to Bob in his work in 1980. And I know that you were introduced. So a little bit of background. Paul, I'm going to give a little bit of background, and then I'd like you to tell our listeners a little bit more about you. But would you keep me honest as I do this? I want to make sure I tell the truth.
I will.
All right. Paul actually comes from a family with deep connections to healthcare and to dentistry. It was sort of preordained that you were going to go into healthcare and that you were going to be a dentist. Is that true, Paul?
Yeah. I mean, it was almost it happened almost in a thoughtless way. It was such a high expectation. It was almost not even, it wasn't really discussed much, you know? I just thought that was my role in life. You know, another Henny had to be a dentist and try to make the world better through dentistry. So that's sort of the way it happened. I didn't do a lot of research and other things. It was just sort of the family thing to do.
That's what you were going to do.
Yeah.
Well, and sure enough, Paul, of course, had to, you know, had to perform. You know, you had to go to college. You had to get into dental school. You had to pass dental school. And you graduated in 1984 from the University of Michigan.
That's right.
And that's really where you started on your path to realize your potential as a dentist. And we were talking in our pre-production phone call. We were talking about your pathway of discovering Bob Barkley and discovering the humanistic or people side of dentistry. And you shared something very insightful in our discussion. If you don't mind, Paul, I'll share that with our listeners. I asked you, well, what was it that got you interested in this? And you gave me a one-word answer that I thought was flat-out brilliant. You said, failure.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. Would you tell our listeners a little bit about that? Because, you know, anybody that I love it when speakers get up there and they act like they've never made a mistake and never failed. Well, if they've never failed, then one of two things is happening. Either they're lying, right?
Right.
Or you know, they are simply have too big of an ego to recognize the mistakes that they've made. And I love it when you said that because I think all of our listeners can identify with failure. Would you share a little bit more insight into that that discovery and that pathway with our listeners?
Sure. You know, just kind of going back to my family heritage in dentistry, my father was an oral surgeon. So I grew up as a child, grew up around dentistry all the time. And my father's brother, Frederick, was world-renowned oral surgeon who practiced out of Ford Hospital in Detroit and was really one of the pioneers who transformed oral surgery into being primarily an exodontic, especially to being a head and neck surgery profession where oral surgeons were in operating rooms because of automobile accidents and orthognathic surgeries and all this stuff. And my uncle Frederick was one of the people that first pioneered all of this stuff. And if you look in old textbooks, he's sort of like the Peter Dawson of his time.
But by the way, Paul, we didn't talk about this, but I actually know of your father and your uncle. Uh-huh. I lecture every year, pretty much every year at AMIS, at the American Association of Oromaxillofacial Surgeons. Mm-hmm. And I know of your dad and your uncle through the history of AMIS, and you're exactly right. They were influential in really developing the specialty of oral surgery into what it is today.
Yes. And in fact, he was like president of the Royal Academy of Surgeons in Britain. I mean, he was just a phenomenal leader in dentistry and oral surgery. So from a family point of view, there was tremendous expectations put on myself as well as my brother, who's a dentist. And there really wasn't a whole lot of, like I said, there wasn't a whole lot of discussion about whether or not we were going to do this. It was like, well, where are you going to take it? You're going to take the bar higher. So, you know, I went through dental school at the University of Michigan, and which, you know, is extremely fine dental school, and everything is, optimal in terms of training. And as we were kind of talking in pre-production, we don't really get exposed to the human side of dentistry very much in dental school because we're so focused on everything else, getting out of there being number one. But technically, you know, being able to do a gold inlay perfectly and a crown and a set of dentures or whatever. So I sort of entered dentistry with a sort of idealistic mindset and went through dental school without it really being challenged. And then when I came out of school and started seeking employment, starting in associateships, I was slapped square in the face with the fact that dentistry was very different than what I had thought it was from my experience and it had been told. So I had gone into one particular associateship for what turned out to be a fairly short period of time where it was extremely insurance-centered. The patients wouldn't do anything but what their insurance covered. And one day I was having a cup of coffee in the lab, and I looked up at this long row of cases which had been returned from the lab, crowns and bridges. And, you know, I picked them up to see how good the preps were, you know, how dentists are. and then I looked at the date that the case had been done, and it was like 2 and 3 years prior to that. And I went to the owner dentist and I said, Ron, why are these cases sitting on the shelf? Why aren't they delivered? And he said, well, they never came back because they didn't want to make the copayment.
what a reality check, huh? Welcome to the real world, Dr. Paul.
Yeah, right. Can you repeat that to me? They what? So, you know, that was sort of one of my earlier exposures to it, in addition to just sort of being in a practice where the patients really didn't treat the doctor with any kind of professional respect, that this was not at all what I was expecting. Not that I think I come down from on high and everything that I utter has to be followed, but at least, you know, let's have a little dignity and treat each other with some respect.
Well, let's at least come back and seat the bridge that you
right.
started.
You know, I mean, as a new dentist in a practice, and I'm sure some of the listeners have experienced this in associateship situations, you can walk into a room and you're doing the hygiene check. You've never met them before. And you walk in and you say, hello, Mrs. Smith, how are you today? And what Mrs. Smith does is like, look away and look at the wall. She doesn't even want to have any kind of personal contact with you. She's just resentful that you're not Dr. Ron or whatever, you know?
Yeah. Well, can I be sarcastic for just a minute? I'm generally not sarcastic, but I'd like to be sarcastic for just a minute. Paul, I'm sure none of our listeners can relate to anything that you're saying here. Okay. Tongue firmly planted in cheek, very sarcastic, as I'm sure every one of our listeners at some level can identify with what you're saying here.
So, you know, that sort of, it shocked me. And I thought, what have I gotten myself into? Is dentistry really what I thought it was? And I really started to think, this sort of goes back to your oral story we were talking about earlier in pre-production about David Hornbrook and his experience. I really thought I picked the wrong profession. I hadn't thought about this enough. I just assumed, you know, my parents said this was going to be great. And here I am in a situation that I absolutely felt terrible about. I didn't like seeing patients in that circumstance. So,
well, at the very least, Paul, you expected, like I said, you're humble yourself. You didn't expect patients to put you on a pedestal, but you expected patients to have some interest in how you could help them.
I expected dentistry to be health oriented. When in fact the patients that I was interacting with saw it simply as a transaction, or as Bill Brown said, I was a transactional dentist. It was, they're trading me their money, or in this case, their token currency money insurance, for something I'm going to do for me. So it's sort of been managed down to sort of like a barter arrangement, or, you know, you're just sort of a skilled tradesman, but if there isn't any health-centered mission to it.
So you just introduced a phrase that will be new to some of our listeners, and I love that phrase. And it was Bill Brown that I first heard it from as well, which is, you know, there's different types of dentist, and one type would be characterized as a transactional dentist. In other words, they're trading something for something that you do for them. Mm-hmm. Talk about what you are today. You're a practicing dentist in Roanoke.
Yes.
And, you know, to help our listeners understand, you have a general practice that focuses on comprehensive care. How would you label yourself today? If Bill Brown labeled some dentists as transactional dentists, how would you label yourself today?
The label that I would put on the way we work with people is relationship-based health-centered dentistry. So there is it's goal oriented. They're not my goals. They're not goals that I'm putting on other people or expectations I'm putting on them. They're actually goals that we collaboratively develop together. And we work as a team, me, the patient, my staff. We work with them to achieve goals that we together have developed. It's sort of very parallel sometimes, I think, to like a financial planner. You go in and you say, I have X resources, but I want to get at X times 50, 30 years from now. How do I do that? Mm-hmm. And you start at the beginning and you envision where you want to be, and you look at what you have to work with, and you establish strategies over time to get there. And so that's kind of what we do in the simplest, you know, way to explain it.
Well, and I love the way you've characterized it as relationship-based dentistry. Everything we do in our practice and at Life Smiles, Paul, is built around that concept. Our listeners have heard me talk about that it's very much a relationship-based practice. And I am such a believer. I was very fortunate to learn this from Dr. Reed, from Omar Reed in 1980, where he talked about dentistry as being a people game. In fact, every one of his courses was subtitled, regardless of what the, you know, the title of the course was, it was subtitled Dentistry, the People Game. And mm-hmm. That's how strongly he felt about it. Well, hey, let's use this as a transition to introduce our listeners to Bob Barkley, a mentor to me and a mentor to you, and hopefully now a mentor to our listeners. So for our listeners' benefit, Paul, who was Bob Barkley? And more importantly, why should our listeners even care? Because here we are over 40, 50 years later after his epic work. Why should our listeners even, you know, who was he and why should they even care?
Right. That's a beautiful, beautiful question, an appropriate question really to ask, Gary. Why is this even relevant in the era, you know, the era of computer assisted dentistry and all of the technology that is around us that's amazing, why do we want to hearken back to a fellow who developed ideas back in the late 50s and 60s and 70s? Mm-hmm. How can that even remotely be relevant to what we're doing today? You know?
Wait, I know this one. And I know so, this one. Wait. So, I'll let you share it.
Right. But I'll counter that question point with the fact that some of the things that Bob Barkley developed back in the late 50s and 60s and 70s are things that have influenced every dentist that practices today, more likely, if not directly, indirectly. There are some words in our vocabulary now that came to being because of Bob Barkley's work, and we'll talk a little bit about that today.
It's almost like, you know, just to draw a parallel, it's like, you know, when Einstein discovered the theory of relativity, that was a breakthrough, and it's still relevant today. It hasn't changed, has it? And I think the same thing is true. I think the same thing is true with Bob's work, that there are fundamentals there in the human condition that apply today as they applied in the late 50s and 60s and 70s to Bob. So tell our listeners a little bit about who he was.
Bob Barkley obviously was a dentist. He grew up in a small farming community in kind of west central Illinois. You know, back in as a child, grew up there in the 30s and the 40s. A little town called Ipava, and it was maybe 600 people at the time. And he said it was the kind of town where you could be the school valedictorian because you were the only one in your class. So this is the kind of world that he came from. And he eventually went to dental school at Northwestern University, which graduated some amazing people over the years. Right. And unfortunately, it was closed, I think, for the wrong reasons. But
in the 70s.
Yeah, that's another story for another day. But Bob, when he graduated from dental school, he had to make a decision on where he wanted to practice. Initially, thought he wanted to practice in Chicago, like we all do. You know, we fall in love of where we went to dental school, and we never want that, you know, sort of fun experience to end. But he ended up moving back to Macomb, Illinois, which is not too far from Ipava. It's a little closer to the Mississippi River, I think, but it's about maybe 20,000 people or so at that point in time, and that's where he set up his family practice. So he graduated, I think, in 1954. He did a couple years in the Air Force because of the Korean War obligation, and then started a practice in Macomb in the late 50s. And he started a family practice there, and he started his family there as well with Phyllis. They had five children there. And he started practicing, and within a fairly short period of time of practicing, he noticed that his dentistry was failing, that people were coming back with cavities around their fillings and things just not working out. These patients were not getting healthier. So his first response was the way we all of us dentists react to that, with because the way we're trained and probably because of the psyche we have to choose dentistry in the first place. But we tend to blame ourselves and we say, well, there's something technically inadequate about what I'm doing.
You're not doing something right here. You're something that you're doing is contributing to this condition that you're seeing.
Mm-hmm. Right. So his conclusion was, amalgams just aren't good enough. I need to learn how to do cast gold. And so he went, through contact with people, helped him learn a higher and higher levels of training. And so he started proposing more and more fine and elaborate and expensive dentistry to his patients at Macomb, thinking that, you know, this was the solution. If I just do finer dentistry, it will be more successful, and I'll be more successful as a dentist. I'll feel better about myself, and the patients will like me better, and, you know, the world will happily go on. But the opposite occurred. The more expensive his treatment plans became, the more elaborate the dentistry was that he proposed, the more his patients rejected it. Not only that, they started to leave his practice. And so he was very concerned about that. It wasn't that Bob couldn't sell dentistry. In fact, I was fortunate enough to listen to a CD of him speaking in Raleigh, North Carolina around 1970 or so. And he said, I can sell anything to anyone at any time, even to a cow, as long as my hands aren't cold. So Bob,
I can imagine him saying that. Yes.
And he had this very folksy charm about him, and he could just mesmerize everybody with his country stories and his speaking style. So selling dentistry was never his problem. It was getting people to see dentistry in a broader light and see the relevance of paying more for a restoration, let's say out of gold, than amalgam, that sort of thing. So he was very frustrated by that. And so he decided that the problem, again, the kind of the typical dentist response to this, well, I've got to learn more. There's something I'm missing technically. So he proceeded on, and he eventually ended up at the Pankey Institute. No, this is really before the Pankey Institute, back right. when Dr. Pankey was just doing three-day courses down in Coral Gables. And he went down there and took some classes from Dr. Pankey. And Dr. Pankey basically taught him that there's a behavioral side of dentistry. There's a psychological side of dentistry, and that you need to start working with your patients as people, not just as individuals walking in with teeth problems. And so there was this introduction that there needs to be a philosophy of your practice, as well as being technically excellent. And so this really sort of rung some bells in Bob's head. And I assume, I don't know the exact dates, but this is probably around 1960 or so, 1960, 62. And so he was fascinated by what he was learning at from Dr. Pankey, and he said he had memorized everything that Dr. Pankey did. He was so good communicating with people that he memorized every word to the word. He memorized it, and then he brought it back to Macomb, and he failed. He said, not only did I fail, I failed miserably. He said, not only that, they left.
I remember Paul in Bob Barkley's book, he talks about when he first was introduced to Dr. L.D. Pankey and the teachings there, and Dr. Pankey shared a bibliography with him of books that he thought dentists would find useful to understand more about psychology and the way people think and so on. And I think at the time that bibliography was about had about 200 titles. Right. And I remember how much it impressed Bob that he said, not only did Dr. Pankey have 200 books in his library on this topic, but he read every one of them.
That's right. And Dr. Pankey, was a fascinating man as well. That's worthy of multiple shows and of itself. But Dr. Pankey actually met Carl Jung. He worked under George Crane, a PhD from Chicago, and he very much evolved this idea of having your practice needs to have it needs to be philosophy centered, it needs to be health centered, and it needs to engage people on a deeper level. And it needs to be more focused and goal-oriented. So Dr. Pankey was really the first pioneer, and then Barkley came along and learned everything he could from Pankey, but he took it home and it didn't work. And this was sort of his failure moment. And it really, this is kind of probably one of the main reasons why this resonated with me so much at the time. I thought, well, here's another guy that failed too, but he worked through it. He came up with a solution. And about that time, Dr. Barkley came to know a guy named Nathan Cohen. Nathan Cohen was a psychologist. He actually had a degree in law. He had a PhD in education. He was a kind of a Renaissance guy. And he started working with Dr. Barkley probably around 1960, maybe even sooner. And he started to help Bob integrate what some people call humanistic methods into his practice, meaning more patient-centered focus instead of problem-centered focus. And this evolved over time into Bob developing what is today commonly called co-discovery or co-diagnosis, which was a very specific method that Bob came to know his patients and worked with them collaboratively. Bob also, through the work of a University of Texas professor, Dr. Arnhem, Sumter Arnhem, who did a lot of research in the area of preventive dentistry. This was another avenue that Bob pursued adamantly, spoke all over the world about it. Bob was really the main force behind what we call today preventive dentistry. This was a concept that was not widely known or accepted or integrated into practice. It primarily existed in university settings.
Well, I think it's important for our listeners to understand the context when all this was going on. And this is the late 50s, early mid 60s. And if you study the history of our dental profession, many have characterized that time period as the golden age of dentistry. And that's not a reference to the material of choice, by the way. But and what they meant by that was, you know, just pick, you know, pick a time frame. By now we're talking about the early to mid 60s. And most dentists in the early to mid 60s could hang a shingle and be as busy as they wanted to be being a tooth carpenter repairing teeth. That's how it works. That's how the condition works. So, but what I think is important to understand is that this wasn't a case of Bob not being busy and not being productive and not making a nice living. By the way, was handsomely compensated for doing just that. But he had an itch he wanted to scratch, and the itch was he wanted to have greater success in helping his patients become healthy. And he was failing at that. In fact, there's a particular case. I'll put you on the – is it okay if I put you on the spot?
Well,
I think you'll recall this because it's sort of it was a kind of a seminal experience for Bob. But there was a particular patient in his practice, and this was I don't know the exact time period, but it was early in his practice in Macomb, and Bob remembered her because she was the head cheerleader in his class, and he always. Really admired this gal as being attractive and bright and you know, someone that was, you know, someone who was successful. Would you mind sharing that the Reader's Digest condensed version of that story? Because I think it'll help our listeners understand.
I'd love to. Essentially, so let me sort of pick it up where I was. Bob had learned to do more and more elaborate dentistry. He learned how to do, you know, comprehensive case presentations. You know, he learned about equilibration. He learned about all of this stuff, and he was being faced with more and more patients saying no, and a lot of them just saying goodbye. And so this particular gal came in who he had gone to high school with that he had very, you know, positive memories of in terms of being very attractive and so forth. Maybe she was the second person in his class, I don't know. But I don't know how many cheerleaders they had in IPAVA, but it couldn't have been too many. So she came into his office with her mouth completely debilitated. And she had had, I think, three or four children. And she came in, and this is common. This is kind of a central key point that if we don't get in today, we can get it another time. She came into her head with a certain worldview of what dentistry was and kind of myths about it. And one of the myths was, you know, the old myth, if you haven't heard it, every time you have a child, you lose a tooth. And that having children draws the calcium out of your teeth, and that's why this all happens. And so she had, you know, a history of failed relationship with dentistry, plus these kind of cultural myths that are in her head. And look at this in the context of Bob experiencing all these failures with presenting big treatment plans to people, case presentations. And he thought, you know, I am not going to do it this time. I'm going to do it the old-fashioned way. I'm just going to tell her to, you know, show her how to improve her hygiene a little bit. And then I am going to just suggest some very basic, inexpensive care. I want to create a treatment plan that she will not reject.
I'm not going to chase her away.
We're going to, you know, I don't want to lose her as a friend. So I'm just going to tell her what she wants to hear, basically, you know. And so they agree and they set a time to have, you know, the treatment commence. And the time comes and the time passes and she doesn't show up. And Bob can't even understand remotely why this would happen. I mean, he made it as easy as possible for her to say yes and proceed. And it's later on that year, apparently, he ran into her downtown or something, and he saw that he had what he called, she had committed dental suicide, meaning that she had all of her teeth extracted and she was wearing a full set of upper and lower dentures.
And she at this time, I believe, is mid-20s age-wise, mid to
right,
late 20s,
yeah,
maybe?
Right, mm-hmm, right. Yeah. Mm-hmm, yeah. And this was kind of the sort of epiphany moment for Bob, where he realized that if he didn't get better at communicating and connecting with people and selling the value of what he did, he would actually cause people to make the wrong decisions for themselves health-wise. This sort of thing just really resonated with me as well. So this, you know, this when he started working with Nathan Cohen and other people, and this is really when things started to gain some momentum. With Bob, that particular experience. So that's a fascinating thing, mm-hmm, that moved him forward a lot. And Nathan Cohen did some other things that were quite revolutionary. I mean, if you read back into some of the references on his book, at that time, Nathan Cohen was doing personality testings on employees. Mm. He was doing team building. He was doing leadership stuff that we do today, but it's almost unfathomable to think that this man was doing this stuff at this point in time.
Right, right, right. Hey, let's tie this back to you. Now that our listeners know more about Bob and his mm-hmm kind of foundation and the things that really motivated him, and really at the core of what was motivating Bob was to helping people get healthy. And he was one that I would consider to be just a real father of the movement of preventive dentistry, how to prevent future problems and
yes,
how to help people get healthier, and a prevention oriented practice, which was absolutely radical at the time. And to some degree it is still cutting edge today. But how about you personally? This ties back to you. How did you personally come to learn about Bob's work and why did it influence you so much?
Well, you know, going back to my very early experiences in dentistry, I think my associateship in that particular office I was telling you about earlier, that only lasted for maybe 3 months. And I just realized this wasn't a good fit. I didn't know what I was going to do. So I started searching around in the community for other opportunities. And I just happened to luck into connecting with and talking a lot with this other dentist in town who had actually studied at the Pankey Institute. Avram King had been consulting him. He had at some point or another been in contact with Omari because he had information on that as well. Mm-hmm. And there was a lot, and Avram King talked an awful lot about Barkley. So that's sort of when I first heard that name. And as well as I discovered that a lot of these writings, a lot of the work that Nathan Cohen was doing was really based out of some of the work that Carl Rogers was doing. It was based out of work that like Ben Singer and Peter Drucker and mm-hmm others. And so I started just reading all this stuff. And I just became fascinated with it. And I started to try to figure out how am I going to integrate this into my practice, because this was a way of practicing that I really could find a lot of joy in. And that, you know, that's the way I practice today. Was over time, I bought a practice. Actually a lot like Dr. Hornbrook's practice. It was completely unlike what I wanted, and over time developed it into what I did want over various stages in time and strategies.
So if you're listening to this and you're in that situation, you're in a practice that, you know, you perhaps bought a practice, or maybe you even started one that developed into something that it's like not quite what you want, understand that you can evolve it. And
yeah,
I love that saying. Omer taught me the saying that if it's been done before, it must be possible.
Yes.
Others have done that, and you can be successful with that as well. Paul, I want to get real practical here for just a minute. And by the way, I just want I want to, I'll put you back on the spot. Is it okay if I put you back on the spot?
Go for it.
Could we have you back on the show? I'd love to have you come on back because this is a topic that is, I am so passionate about. And I know you are as well. I'd love to have you come on back and share more of this information. So we're not going to get through all of it today, but mm-hmm. at least we'll get it introduced to our listeners and put it on the radar screen and get them on a pathway that is really exciting. But could we have you come on back sometime?
Oh, I'd love to come back. Yeah. Cool.
Well, yeah, I want to get practical here for just a minute. And we'll spend a few minutes talking about this. For our listeners today, and our listeners are very diverse. They are range from dental students. We have some listeners that are dental students on one end of the extreme to, I received an email the other day from one of our listeners who's 78 years old and is excited about dentistry today as he was when he started.
Yeah.
And we have listeners in 149 countries. Which is kind of cool. So we're helping patients get healthier all around the world. For our listeners, what are some takeaway points that you'd like them to leave with? So we're talking about Bob Barkley. We're talking about relationship-based health-centered dentistry. You shared your own pathway, which was one of frustration, where you here you are working as an associate in the practice, and you look in the lab, and there's cases back ready to be put in the mouth, and the patient won't even come back and have it done because they've got to pay a little bit.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So, and our listeners are going to understand that to some degree, they have some experience with that. What are some takeaway points that they can use today? Literally when they're done listening to this, they can go back to work and apply.
Okay. Let me give you a few. Let me start with a quote from Bob Barkley, and it goes like this. And I said, you had a lot of country isms. Here's one, a great one. Telling ain't teaching and listening ain't learning. Okay. We're all taught in dental school that if we just tell people what they need to do, they will use logic and they'll follow through. But in fact, this is rarely the case. People don't learn well that way. Dentists suffer from a disorder that I call splainitis, and they try to explain too much, commonly too soon. So we need to know that every patient is different. They're different on a personality level, from an experience with dentistry level, from a perception of what dentistry is and the value of it in their life. And they vary in terms of how they view dentistry relative to their total health, what their goals are. They may have memories that are accurate. They may have memories that are complete distortions. They have different financial situations. They have different levels of influence by third-party payers. So we have got to acknowledge this truth and deal with each individual patient as a person. We need to use a technique that Edgar Schein, I don't know if you're familiar with him, calls humble inquiry. We need to listen, and we need to guide conversations towards allowing the patient to kind of discover for themselves what they want from dentistry and verbalize that.
Yeah, so I love it. I love it, Paul, when synergy happens organically. Recently I had my dear friend, Ashley Ladder, on the show. I don't know if you know Ashley, Paul, but I'd like to introduce you to him. He's just a wonderful resource, out of the UK. Mm-hmm. He's a former executive, with the Dale Carnegie Organization. And today he spends his time focusing on working with dentists to talk about ethical communication and ethical sales, for dentists, sales skills for dentists. And recently we had him on the show, and his entire focus was about, on that show, was about how dentists need to ask more questions. Instead of just leaning the patient back and identifying what the concern is and jumping in with the solution, need to start by asking questions. And you're saying the same thing here, aren't you?
Yeah, exactly. And, we also need to be aware that long-term success with patients is directly related to the quality of what really Carl Rogers called helping relationships with others. In other words, you enter this relationship with the intention of helping them grow and to become healthier. That's your agenda. That's the upfront agenda for you.
Begin with the, and put another way, coming from Stephen Covey, begin with the end in mind.
Yes.
In other words,
yes,
your intention. So let's get real practical with this. So imagine, you know, I'll just role play it as a listener here, Paul. Imagine that one of our doctors is listening to this, and he or she has a new patient on the schedule this afternoon. And they're meeting them for the first time. How can they apply some of these concepts in meeting that patient for the first time? And let's say hypothetically, this is a patient with not in an urgent situation. They're here because they've recently moved to town. They want to get established with a good dentist, and they're here as a new patient.
I would suggest, frankly, by beginning with putting the paper and pen down or laptop, whatever it is that you transcribe information onto at a first visit, and sit down in a quiet space with that person and ask one simple question, and that is, how can I help you today? And just shut up. Mm-hmm. And that's where we begin.
Wow.
They may present with exactly what you want to hear, or they might start someplace else, but that's where you have to begin, is where their mind is at that particular moment.
I had the privilege of meeting Dr. Pankey late in his life. And, you know, he calls this meeting the patient where they are.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
But what a great question for any of our listeners to put on their hip and to use as a way to begin a relationship with someone. How can I, and it was as simple, I mean, make sure I've got it. It's if I were the dentist and you were my patient, Paul, I might say, you know, Paul, it's great to meet you today. We love seeing new patients. How can I help you today?
Exactly. Exactly. Dr. Pankey used to say it differently. He used to say, "What's your problem?" That doesn't work for me.
He could get away with that. Yes.
Apparently so. But, you know, you have to start with each person where they're at emotionally and otherwise, you know, with their frame of mind, how accurate it is or not, because we have to acknowledge that significant learning, and that's really your goal, is to move the patient from where they are now to a greater point of understanding so that they can make better decisions. If they make better decisions, they buy better treatment plans. If they buy better treatment plans, you're more productive. And they're happier because you're doing the dentistry the right way. It's going to be successful long term. So
I love the way you said that, Paul. I mean, it really does resonate with me, because I've always taken and appreciated an educational approach. I don't know, maybe it's naive, but certainly our results speak to the success of it. And that's that we can educate our patients to make good decisions about their oral health. Perhaps not everyone.
But not everyone.
Many patients, we can educate them, and it's really not so much education, it's really connecting, isn't it? You can connect
it's
with
not,
them.
And that kind of leads me to another point I'd like to leave listeners with today, is that, and this comes from Carl Rogers, actually a book he wrote in 1969. And he said significant learning occurs primarily through experiences. And those experiences are self-discovered and self-appropriated learning situations. So when we're engaging a new patient, we're not trying to, sometimes you'll hear in education, mug and jug approach. You've got all the information. They're an empty container. You're going to dump it in there. And when it's full, they're going to act exactly the way you want them to. That's not the way humans work. Actually, the way humans learn optimally is by experiencing, and we all do that. So the concept behind co-discovery is to intentionally create learning moments where the patient's learning something about themselves, and really the doctor and team are learning at the same moment.
Give an example of that for our listeners who are trying to get their arms around. Of course, I've spent a lot of time, you know, studying the co-discovery and co-diagnosis concepts. And really, that's one of the things I want to have you come on back and you and I do a deeper dive in, is the whole realm of co-discovery and co-diagnosis. But for our listeners that might be hearing this for the first time and trying to get their arms around it, give an example of how we can lead a patient to an experience that's going to help them with this.
Well, maybe let's just start with something kind of simple. You've you moved on, were actually doing the clinical exam, which is done at a very strategic time in the Barkley method, and I follow that pretty devoutly. But you're at the point where you're doing a clinical exam with the patient, and literally I mean with the patient. Whatever findings you are discovering, you're trying to set up a situation where they're kind of experiencing it and thinking about it at the same time you are. TMJ issues are kind of a good way to do that, easy way to do that. You lay the patient back. You ask them about joint sounds. You may palpate the joints. There may be a click or a pop, and you start a conversation. Have you ever noticed that before? Well, yeah, it happens every now and then, particularly when I open and like bite into a sub sandwich or something. Well, do you ever have any pain with it? Well, usually not, but 2 weeks ago, I woke up one morning and it was hurting pretty bad, and then it kind of went away. And then, so that sort of leads you into an opportunity. That's sort of the learning moment. Then you get to explain a little bit about, do you know anything about the anatomy of the jaw joint? There's actually a disc in that. That sound that you hear is actually that disc wobbling around. And we know that healthy jaw joints make no noise whatsoever. So the simple fact that your joints are making a sound means that you have some type of dislocation in that joint. Has anybody ever mentioned that to you before? No. That's sort of an example,
and oh,
you
what can a great you, example,
and you don't really want to get into too deep at that moment. You just want to put the thought out there. It's sort of, you know, developing the relationship and their understanding is a process that takes time, and you want to wait for the optimal time. And the best time to talk about joint anatomy and function is not with a patient laying back in a kind of vulnerable state. It's actually with you in a conference room, showing them things visually that they can touch and understand better. So you sort of lay down little breadcrumbs, and you lead them in a direction of greater learning. It's a creation of learning moments is kind of the concept of it.
Yeah, awkward analogy, but it's I'm teaching my granddaughter to ride a bike. You know, and I suppose I could get out a whiteboard and explain the physics of right. bicycle riding.
Exactly.
And I suspect she would look at me with wide eyes, and her eyes would say, "Please stop talking, Poppy."
Right. Avram King, I can remember distinctly Avram King talking about this one time. And he said, you know, early on in a relationship, the patient doesn't really know enough to even ask the right questions. And when they do ask a question, they really, because you haven't explored it very deeply, you want to respond very simply. And he gave the example of a five-year-old asking their mother about where do babies come from. Okay, so we can get into a very elaborate anatomical explanation, developmental explanation of that. But he's saying the answer that you need to give early on in the relationship is from your mommy's tummy. And that satisfies them, and it sets the stage for a more, you know, more appropriate explanation at a time when they're more open to learning about it, when it's more relevant to them.
Right. And I love the way you're tying it back to, experiential learning. So back to, you know, my granddaughter, Juliana, here, teaching her to ride a bike. And, if she's wobbling down the road and I stop her and I can show her how to be more stable in her writing, she's going to respond to that very well because it's so immediate. It's right there.
Absolutely.
And I love this idea of creating experiences for patients because that's really where they're learning. And you used the example of TMJ or TMD. And I could imagine same thing with, say, periodontal health.
Absolutely.
There's a parallel there with periodontal health because there's a lot of, myths. You raised the myth of, Bob's patient operating under the premise that, every time you have a child, you lose a tooth. Well, in the same way, there's people out there that think that, well, everyone's gums bleed, Dr. Henny, right?
Right.
I mean, everyone's gums bleed. That's just normal. And that's their myth. That's the urban myth. That's the mythology that you have to bust with that.
And there's a lot of danger. This is where Avram King's wisdom kind of came into play. There's a lot of danger in presenting too much information too fast. They either can't comprehend it and they'll reject it, or they'll be threatened by it. and they won't proceed for that reason.
So it's definitely, so, there's a timing and a
absolutely.
Sequence.
You've got to be reading this person and listening to them and sensing for where they are in terms of the learning cycle.
You know, maybe one of the ways that our listeners can get their arms around this is, I opened my D1 class, you know, at Midwestern University School of Dental Medicine when it's their first day in D1 in the fall. I open with a L.D. Pankey quote, and it says, always remember that there's a person attached to those teeth. Mm-hmm. And it's fundamental, but I believe that if we can always remember that, it's going to, you know, guide how we interact with them and how we develop relationships with them. And one thing I want to sort of give a hopeful message to our listeners. I believe the world today is hungrier for this than they've ever been.
I think you're dead on with that. I mean, I experience that every day, every week.
May I share with you, Paul, why I think
sure.
that's true? And,
yeah.
and you,
yeah.
you know, correct me if you feel differently
sure.
or add to it. The reason why I think the world is hungry for this, people are hungry for this, is that as much as I love technology and I will absolutely confess to being a geek and a nerd, I love technology. As much as we love that, there still is a strong craving and desire for one-to-one human connection. And that's disappearing. Sort of in dribs and drabs, it's disappearing. You think about, in the not so distant past, the common situation, if you wanted to purchase something, you'd go to a brick and mortar store and you'd interact with a clerk
right.
or a salesperson or someone would help you with that. Today, I can simply open up my browser and I can go to the world's biggest store, Amazon.com, and buy anything I want without interacting with anybody.
Right.
And so as that happens, I believe that there's a craving at a cellular level that people crave human interaction. And at least some people, perhaps not everybody, but at least some patients want to be taken care of by a dentist and team who they know, like, and trust.
And that is particularly true with people who are experiencing or insightful enough to know that their problem is complex. And, you know, your example of, changes in retail and so forth is very relevant. But let's even get closer to home than that. Let's talk about medicine.
Yes.
Where you can go into a primary care provider and they will hardly look in your eyes. They're too focused on putting entries into their laptop. And, for example, my wife has had some complicated GI issues. And we got referred to what was supposed to be a very well-regarded specialist here in town. And she had a list of about 10 questions that she wanted to ask him about the problems that she was having. And she came back from that appointment crying because he didn't take the time to even answer one.
Well, and to quantify that, let's quantify the challenge. And this is hard data. This is not just anecdotal data. This is hard data. The average general practitioner physician, your wife was going to a specialist, that was a different case, but the average general practitioner MD sees 80 to 100 yeah. patients a day. Now, just
right.
do the math. Take the low end of that, 80
right.
patients, assuming an eight-hour day, that means that the average patient interaction time is 6 minutes. How can they even get to know your name?
They can't.
You know, in that time? They can't. And yet dentistry presents such a different opportunity, doesn't it?
It's huge. And, that's kind of my last takeaway I want to put out there today, which is that we don't need a lot of patients in our practice every month to be productive. We need a handful of people that we can engage and develop into people who are interested in comprehensive, proper care.
I'm convinced,
so
Paul, you and I are siblings from a different mother.
Yeah,
we're siblings from. This has been
it's just
a core principle.
It's not that complicated. We don't need 60 and 80 people enough a month. We need like 12, mm-hmm. you know, and it is so much more fun to work with people in an organized, goal-oriented, health-oriented way. That's really where the jazz comes in for me, is when we take a patient through this process and they're appreciating how hard we work, you know, the time that we put into design and a wax up or the provisionals or whatever it is, they've got a sense for it because I took the time to develop that value in them. It was there. It was latent. but we caused it to kind of bubble through this to the surface because of these learning moments we were talking about earlier. So, you know, we don't need huge volumes of people.
You know, if you're doing the math as you're following along, Paul's been in practice over 32 years, and I think it's fair to say, I'll use your word because I love it, you're still jazzed about being a dentist. Mm-hmm. and it's because of how you're practicing. Paul, I know I can't wait to have you back and dive into co-discovery and co-diagnosis, but there's a way that our listeners can kind of fill in some of the missing pieces. I hope what we've done in this interview is really spark some interest. And I know we've done that. And I know our listeners are going to want to, dive deeper into that. And you have created an amazing resource called the Bob Barkley Study Club on Facebook.
Right.
And I love social media, and I know many of our listeners through social media. And you've created a resource on Facebook called the Bob Barkley Study Club. Can you talk a little bit about what that is and what it's about, and how our listeners can use that resource to learn more about this critically important topic?
Sure. My Facebook page on the Bob Barkley Study Club Facebook page is actually an outgrowth of work that I've done with other dentist friends that I had starting way back in 1996, I think, when we were all going through the Pankey Institute together. And I was sharing with them some of the stuff that we're talking about today.
So you're just trying to keep it alive, you know.
And we formed a group of people that basically encouraged each other as we made changes in our practice. And when we hit walls and frustrations, we could call each other up and say, hey, you won't believe this, but I did this and that happened. And the person would say, you know what? That's exactly what happened to me too. So we had this kind of group of people, then we shepherded each other through this process, and each of us created our own patient-centered practice with our own kind of version of it, our own fingerprints on it, but they're all fantastic, beautiful practices. This Facebook page is really just sort of my evangelical moment where I thought, you know, this is such a fun, unique way to practice healthcare. I need to share it more. This stuff that I learned from Bob Barkley and others is so amazing that to kind of keep it hidden in the corner and for just a small group of people to kind of know about it isn't really fair or right or even good for patients long term. So I created the Bob Barkley Study Club Facebook page, sort of like, I don't know about you, Gary, but today I get a lot of my news I get off Facebook now. Yeah. I've got Facebook feeds from all the main news centers that I'm interested in. And I thought, what if I created a Facebook page that basically put out their positive things about patient-centered dentistry on a regular basis and kind of kept the momentum going? When people were like really down, something hadn't gone right, they get a positive message on their phone every day or something like that.
That was
the idea behind it. And interestingly enough, I've had just all kinds of people, a lot of well-known consultants in dentistry today, you even being one of them, coming forward to me and saying, oh, by the way, Bob Barkley was a huge influence on my life too.
Yeah.
So, and I'm getting younger dentists going, gosh, tell me more about this. Who was this guy?
Yeah. What's this about?
So, you know, it's there for people to learn more about it. So you can just like that page.
By the way, I'll put, if you're listening and you're driving, don't take your hands off the steering wheel. I will put a link to the Bob Barkley Study Club on Facebook in the show notes. You can get the show notes at TACAS, TAKACS, learningcenter.com, and it'll be one click. You'll just click on that. It'll take you directly to the Facebook page. And I'd encourage you to like that, like the page, so that way it'll be part of your news feed. And I want to encourage you to jump in and interact as well.
Right.
Typically, what Paul posts there is some kind of a positive thought or concept, or it could be a quote. It could be a series of paragraphs about the whole concept of relationship-based health-centered dentistry. And you'll typically see tons of comments, people jumping in with very relevant comments about what was posted. And I find it to be let me compliment you for just a minute on this, Paul. I find it to be a bright spot in my day when I go to your page.
Well, that, you know, that was the idea.
I find it a bright side. Like, you know, sometimes you just get a little beat up, you know, sometimes, and you need to be uplifted. And,
My wife kind of laughs at me about, and my kids do as well, about all these books I've got piled up everywhere, from, you know, Avram King's book to Lynn Carlisle's book to Bob Barkley's book to L.D. Maggie, and on. They sort of surround me in orbit.
Yeah.
Particularly in the morning. That's kind of how I start my day. Is I'll just randomly pick up a book, and it might be Stephen Covey. It might be L.D. Pankey, it might be Bob Barkley, whoever, and I'll just read a paragraph or two, and I'll think, how incredible and inspiring is that? And I thought, well, why don't I just like share this, you know?
Well,
and it sort of built from there.
As our listeners go to that page, I think you'll find it the same way I find it, which is to be very inspiring, very powerful, very thought-provoking, and just a real positive part of the day. And, you know, Paul, I want to take a minute and say thanks to you. I love the work that you're doing. You're really bringing forward, you know, in 2016 and beyond, the work of some wonderful leaders in the behavioral side of dentistry, Bob Barkley being one of those. And I see it as passing this information along, you know, to the next generation, and you're evolving it, you know, to be relevant in 2016 and beyond. And I want to take a minute and compliment you. This is a labor of love for you, clearly. And I want to thank you for what you're doing, and thank you for what you're doing for the people side or the behavioral side of dentistry, because it is making a massive difference in dentists all over the world.
I appreciate the opportunity to talk about it, and I'd love to, you know, continue the conversation another time. I think you touched on this earlier, Gary. You know, we have a lot of freedom in dentistry to practice the way we want to. It's just sitting out there. It's the golden ring that we need to choose to grasp. Now, I'm not trying to paint some utopian fix that's going to happen overnight, but we have, you know, compared to medicine today, we have got a tremendous amount of freedom. Let's not give that opportunity up.
Along the same line, I have a homework assignment for any of our listeners. And the homework assignment is this. If you haven't done this already, I want to strongly encourage you to do this. And what I mean by this is I'd like you to answer this question. If the world was absolutely perfect, how would you practice dentistry? I'd like you to think about that. And no limitations. If the world was absolutely perfect, how would you like to practice dentistry? What legacy would you like to leave? How would you like to impact your patients? Mm-hmm. And then once you have that clearly in your mind, I want to encourage you to pursue that, because Paul's absolutely right. You can practice dentistry any way you like, regardless of where you are today, regardless of what circumstance you're in today. You may be in, an HMO massive clinic doing tooth carpentry today. You may be in that situation. But over time, you could evolve and you could literally choose to practice dentistry ideally through a series of steps.
Steps
to get there.
And you may be standing in a lab looking at a row of cases that were never delivered.
There you go. Hey, Paul, I know that our listeners might like to reach out to you personally. Would you be kind enough to provide your email address?
Yeah, they can contact me personally by just writing to paul@paulhennydds.com. That's paulhennydds. DDS.com.
And again, I'll put that, I'll put your email address in the show notes. And I'd really like to invite our listeners to reach out to you, Paul. I hope we crash your server. I mean that playfully, of course. But as for a listener, you know, we have listeners in 149 countries. It'd be kind of fun to get some emails from all over the world, wouldn't it?
It absolutely would be exciting.
And you know what? Just reach out and say thanks. Paul's doing some really cool work. You know, just put thanks in the subject line and he'll know you listened to the show. And if you want to write further, go ahead. But, you know, take a minute, pause your phone, send an email and just say thanks. It's paul@paulhennydds.com.
And thanks to you, Gary, for just giving me the little soapbox here to transmit that.
Well, you'll be back on the show and we'll talk, among other things, about co-discovery, co-diagnosis, and we'll talk about how our listeners can start applying that in their practice, among other topics. But thanks again, Paul, for all that you do. And let me take a minute and thank our listeners. We sure love what we do here at the Thriving Dentist Show. We realize we couldn't do what we do if it wasn't for you. Thanks so much for being a listener. There's three ways you can support us. One is that you can tell a colleague about a podcast. You know, there's many dentists that have never heard of the word podcast, and you can help enlighten them about that. In fact, make it experiential. Pull out, you know, to take off on something that Paul taught, make it experiential. Pull out your phone and show them how they can download the Thriving Dentist Show. Secondly, you can write a review on iTunes. Reviews, we have now over 100 reviews. Reviews help us be listed in iTunes and help dentists find us. The third thing that you can do is you can hit the subscribe button. It's free. You can do that on iTunes. You can do that on Stitcher Radio or Google Play or whatever your podcast directory of choice is. Hit the subscribe button. That means every time we upload a new show, every Wednesday, the new show will be automatically uploaded so that you'll never miss a show. On that basis, let me simply say thank you and say I look forward to connecting with you on the next Thriving Dentist Show.
When you cry, be sure to dry your eyes, 'cause better days are sure to come. And when you smile, be sure to smile wide, and don't let them know that they have won. And when you walk, walk with pride, don't show the hurt inside, because the pain will soon be gone. And when you dream, dream big, as big as the ocean blue. When you dream, it might come true. But when you dream, dream big.